So you have to be stunned when you look around this room and you think how big this room is and how many people are here. So I want to just begin by thanking all of you for joining us today and for making this conference, which is the most diverse, largest, and we know most enthusiastic conference we will ever have. So thank you very much. Our opening plenary this morning has four parts. I am going to begin by sharing CFED's views on the state of the field and our thoughts about where we are going. Then we are extraordinarily fortunate to have four of our most visionary and respected leaders in the field to join us to share their own views and their recommendations for the future. Then I will come back and provide a roadmap to the conference, and I want to thank all of you who gave us enormous input into what you wanted and how you wanted it structured. And then I will end by thanking the extraordinarily generous group of sponsors, speakers, and organizers who've all been responsible for making this conference work. So let's get started. As much as I would like to start with a happy note, the financial and economic realities of our time can be defined in three words: inequality, insecurity, and immobility. And because great keynote addresses focus on just a few sources of data to make their point, I'm going to limit myself to three that help describe where we are today. First, let's talk about inequality. And here I'm going to rely on the recent survey of consumer finances from the Federal Reserve. I want to summarize their findings with three headlines. First, no one got a raise except the three percenters. The highest earners had the highest earnings. The top 3% of earners now command 30.5% of all income in this country. The top 10% of earners take home almost half of all the income. The remaining 90% split what is left. Number two, wealth inequality is accelerating even faster than global warming. Between 1989 and 2013, the top 3% of earners went from controlling 45% of all net worth in the United States to controlling 54%. In the same time period, the bottom 90% of earners went from holding 33% of wealth to 25%. And finally, when it comes to the racial wealth gap, I rely on the wisdom of that prophetic economist, Chris Rock, who 10 years ago said, "It's all right, because it's all white. I ain't talking about rich, I'm talking about wealth." 10 years ago, he predicted what is true today, that 90% of all wealth in the United States is held by white households, with black and Hispanic households each having only 3%. But inequality doesn't tell the full story. So let's talk a little bit about financial insecurity, because this helps us understand the impact of this data on people's daily lives. And for this, I rely on CFPB's Assets and Opportunities Scorecard, which I know many of you are familiar with. The one data point that has gotten the most attention is the measure of liquid asset poverty, which has become really the emblem of financial insecurity in this nation. And we found that 44% of US households live in a state of liquid asset poverty, which means they don't have the liquid savings they need to simply exist at the poverty level for 3 months if their main source of income is disrupted by a job loss or an illness or some other problem. This liquid asset poverty number rises to 61% when we're talking about households of color. What has this told us, and what has been the impact of these numbers? The first impact is that it's not just about those poor people. Suddenly, when we talk about insecurity, we're talking about half of the nation. And it brings together a much broader constituency of folks who can address these issues and work on them together. Second, and this is an area that is getting increasing attention, our focus on savings, which is really where this movement began just 20 years ago, has not only been a means for wealth creation, which is how we imagined it, but is an essential ingredient to bring financial stability to households, which has been directly tied to economic growth. People don't make decisions that propel growth unless they feel stable. During this conference, CFPB will release new measures for the very first time of the level of financial insecurity in municipalities and counties. For example, we'll show that there's an enormous range in liquid asset poverty, a low of 11% in Irvine, California, to a high of 75% in Newark, New Jersey. This data will give us the tools to really think about how we customize strategies across geographies that really differ. This story of financial insecurity is best summed up by your favorite newlywed, Kanye West, who said, "Having money's not everything, not having it is." And third, we must pair this focus on inequality and insecurity with data on the prospects for economic mobility, which, as we know, has been the defining characteristic of the American dream. And here we rely on the excellent data of the Pew Charitable Trusts that tells us that 62% of Americans who were born at the top stay there, and 65% of Americans who were born at the bottom stay there for the rest of their lives. And even more astonishing for those of us who were born with this view that America was the land of opportunity in the world, is a study by the Russell Stage Foundation, who found that of all the most developed nations, the United States was third from the bottom in economic mobility. Now, we know these problems were not created overnight. The statistics are the result of centuries of racial discrimination, decades of labor market transformation, and the transfer of power from workers to owners, and the result of the largest recession since the Great Depression, which has stripped households of wealth and generated the high levels of financial insecurity that we discussed. But I don't want you all despairing. While the trends are not new, the attention to these trends are. And I'm sure all of you have experienced this in your work. Who would have imagined when we met 2 years ago that a 700-page economic treatise by Thomas Piketty called Capital in the 21st Century would be a bestseller? Although, as we've heard, nobody's really read it, they just bought it. The media focus has expanded dramatically, with reporters assigned to cover the unbanked and wealth inequality for the first time, and many of them are here, so let's all welcome them. Which has, yes. Which has turned the spotlight onto the very solutions that the asset building movement has been promoting since the beginning. And last week, in a review of Henry Kissinger's new book, Hillary Clinton made our case in global terms. She wrote, "Our country is at its best, and our leadership in the world is strongest when we are united behind a common purpose and shared mission, and advancing shared prosperity and social justice at home. Sustaining America's leadership in the world depends on renewing the American dream for all our people." So, how is our field doing just that? Our field starts by addressing three of the major realities of the 21st century: inequality, insecurity, and immobility. The war on poverty, which we reflected on in a pre-session yesterday, great accomplishment was the creation of the safety net. That singular contribution is necessary, but not enough to prosper in the 21st century. Our country's unfinished business is to add savings and assets to that equation. Our field is designing, testing, and scaling the solutions that address the 21st century realities based on three core principles. Number one, our values are grounded in the belief in the capacity of all people to be productive if given the opportunity and the structure. We have seen vividly the consequences of opportunity denied in communities like Ferguson, and we know that Ferguson is far from alone in the realities that it has faced. Our second commitment is to innovation. We are trying things that have never been done before and marketing them to low-income communities that have always been left behind. This entire conference is a showcase for the innovations that you have created and a platform to share learning and practice. And finally, our third principle lies in our methods. That there is no silver bullet to solve poverty. It takes an approach that integrates and connects multiple strategies, such as embodied in the theme. It is no accident that the theme of this conference is platforms for prosperity. We connect community practice with public policy and private markets, and then build evidence and knowledge of what works through applied research. So what have we accomplished since we last met together? We have created invaluable new knowledge through research, much of which we'll present at this conference. we provide profound insights into the financial realities of low-income lives through the Financial Diaries Project. Books like Scarcity give us a view into the real cost of poverty and how people address that. And you will see the first consumer-driven definition of financial well-being presented at lunch today, along with how we can measure it. We are building new and creative partnerships with the private sector. Through product innovation that is creating savings and transaction accounts, by promoting savings and retirement in the workplace, and applying technology to meet market needs in ways we could never have even imagined 2 years ago. We have pioneered new community-based solutions to promote entrepreneurship, to provide integrated service delivery. We have powered social ventures that support homeowners, college savers, and other entrepreneurs. And we have activated the ability of all to build savings for emergencies and for the long term. We have also seen state and municipal policymakers create the first universal, scaled children's savings programs. We have all stood by the CFPB as it has regulated predatory behavior in the consumer, housing, and student loan marketplaces. And we have watched some of the most influential congressional leaders take up the assets banners again. And I couldn't have asked for better timing when earlier this week, the House of Representatives unanimously, did you hear that word? Unanimously passed the American Savings Promotion Act, a bill that will boost innovative efforts like prized link savings throughout the country. And let's give a shout out to Doorway to Dreams, who's brought prized link savings. And I don't want to get too excited yet, in the coming days, Representative Joe Crowley, the vice chairman of the Democratic Caucus, will introduce the U.S. Accounts, an ambitious proposal to expand the child tax credit and create long-term match savings accounts for every one of the 4 million children born every year in the United States. This has been a dream, pun intended, that we have aspired to for a very long time. And let us not forget how much of the infrastructure that supports this innovation has been built by philanthropy. Over the past 2 years, we have expanded the depth and breadth of our relationship with philanthropy to bring in new funders and create innovative collaborations that leverage the strengths of these institutions and practitioners for much greater impact. But even these accomplishments are not enough to change the trajectory of inequality and insecurity that we all know so much about. To create impact at scale, we have to change one of the structures that are most responsible for income and wealth inequality, and that is the U.S. tax code. In your bags, hot off the press, you have a copy of CFPB's latest report, From Upside Down to Right Side Up. In that report, we show that our government spends a lot of money to help Americans save, invest, and build wealth. When I say a lot, I mean $540 billion in 2013 alone. When you analyze this spending, you show that the top 1% get more support from these programs than the bottom 80% combined. This means that a household that earns upwards of $7.6 million a year would get a benefit conservatively estimated at about $33,000, while a household in the bottom 20%, making about $14,000 a year, would get 77 bucks. To put this in perspective for how upside down the system really is, our data shows that a top income family could buy a Cadillac with their annual benefits, while a bottom income family could barely fill the gas tank. To make a dent in the rising inequality, financial insecurity, and lack of mobility, the work starts now to develop a bold new campaign to transform the tax code into a platform for prosperity. One that's, yes. One that scales savings and asset building opportunities for the asset poor majority. With right side up tax reform, the tax code can be a platform that empowers everyone in this country to start saving at birth for college, home ownership, to start a business, or to invest in another wealth-creating asset so that people who want to can own a home that's healthy, environmentally friendly, and appreciates in value. That would-be entrepreneurs can access the capital and resources that they need to grow their business, and that every household can create a nest egg for an emergency or retirement to be free from the fear that one mishap along the way can lead you down the rabbit hole towards financial disaster. And I know I'm channeling Michael Sheradin, who you'll hear from in a few minutes, when I say we do all this within an institutional structure that makes it easy to save, offers incentives that work, eliminates barriers to participation, and ensures that all of us, if you've read Scarcity, have the bandwidth to live successful, productive lives. As CFED blows out the candles on our 35th birthday tomorrow night, we commit to work with all of you who are here, as well as those of you who could not be here, to expand the movement for economic and racial justice. In the words of Gloria Steinem, speaking at the National Press Club before receiving the Presidential Medal of Freedom, people often ask me, at this age, who am I passing the torch to? First of all, I'm not giving up my torch. Thank you. I'm using my torch to light other people's torches. If we each have a torch, there's a lot more light. As you embark on the next 3 days, I want you to consider this conference as a place where your torch was lit. The more torches we have, the brighter we will shine, and together, we can create a world that is more equal, more financially secure, and provides more economic mobility. Thank you. And with that, it is my extraordinary pleasure to welcome our four plenary speakers. I'll introduce each one of them as I call them up to the stage. Our first speaker is Bill Bynum, who is the president and CEO of Hope Enterprise Corporation and Hope Credit Union, headquartered in Jackson, Mississippi. For more than 3 years, Bill has dedicated his career to building economic opportunity for low-income communities through lending, financial products, and policy. For the past 20 years, he has been working in the Delta to bring fair and affordable consumer financial services to the most underserved region in the country. His work has attracted the attention of national policymakers, and Bill just last week began his term as the chair of CFPB's Consumer Advisory Board. Winner of numerous awards and member of several boards, none more important than CFED. Bill brings us his perspective on the challenges and opportunities of bringing asset building opportunities to the nation's most distressed communities. Next, I have the great opportunity to introduce Bob Anibale, the Global Director at City Community Development. Positioned at the nexus between city's business operations and its community development strategy. Bob has a unique perspective on how we leverage private markets to design and deliver products and programs that expand opportunity in low and moderate income communities as well as communities of color. He also leads city microfinance and works with microfinance institutions all over the world. He has been with Citi since 1982, working globally across all the company's platforms while always guided by an enduring commitment to leverage private markets to meet the needs of the underserved. Bob will reflect on the role of the private sector in the field and the potential of partnerships to promote financial inclusion, savings, and other wealth-building strategies. Our third speaker is Lisa Hasegawa. She has led National Capacity's efforts to be a powerful voice for the unique community development needs of Asian American and Pacific Islander communities since 2000. She is the former chair of the National Council for Asian Pacific Americans and currently serves on the board of the National Low Income Housing Coalition. In May, National Capacity joined La Raza and the National Urban League to release a groundbreaking study called Banking in Color, New Findings on Financial Access for Low and Moderate Income Communities. This report examines how low and moderate income Latino, African American, and AAPI households are meeting their financial needs and the level to which they are financially engaged. Lisa will highlight how her organization's policy efforts are directed at closing the racial wealth gap. Thank you, Lisa. And if anybody needs absolutely no introduction at this meeting, it is Michael Sheratton, the George Warren Brown Distinguished University Professor and Founding Director of the Center for Social Development at Washington University. With the publication of his groundbreaking book, Assets and the Poor, the world has never been the same, and the asset building field was born. He has continued to lead cutting-edge research both domestically and internationally, and shares his talents and insights with communities all over the world. He will share how all his research will help frame out a 21st century policy agenda that is informed by his research and research findings. In 2010, you may remember, he was listed by Time magazine as one of the 100 most influential people in the world, and we are proud to call him a member of our tribe. Michael. And with that, it is my great pleasure to invite Bill to the podium.
Thank you, Andrea. Good morning. Well, I've got to start by saying what an amazing room. I don't know that I've been to many, if any, community development-oriented conferences that are this large, or certainly I can't think of one that is more focused on the issues that we need to be talking about. So congratulations to all of you for being here, and congratulations to Andrea and CFED for pulling us together. I have to start by saying I'm not Chris Rock, nor Kanye, but I am a black man who's been working in this field for 30 years. And I think it's great that Andrea asked the practitioner to launch this conversation, particularly a practitioner from the Deep South. She asked us to talk about the emergence of rapidly developing platforms that have potential to move the needle on many of the issues that we care about. And, you know, I think she's right. I hope she's right that there are rapidly developing technologies, because where I sit, the challenges facing vulnerable people in places seem to be developing quite rapidly, even at an exponential rate. I've come to the conclusion that it's a good thing that many people who are suddenly realizing that people in low-wealth communities, what people in those low-wealth communities knew for a long time, and what many of us who have worked with them and lived with them have known for a long time, that there's a big gap between the haves and have-nots, between the asset-rich and the asset-poor, and it's getting bigger. That's why I'm so glad to be here with the people in this room. You may be the best, if not the only, hope for getting this pursuit of happiness, this more perfect union, this all things are created equal thing right. It may sound like hyperbole, but in the past several months, many of us have taken the time to reflect on Freedom Summer, the March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom, the passage of the Civil Rights Act, the Voting Rights Act, and other seminal civil rights events to shape this country. It's no coincidence that they all took place in or emanated from Mississippi and other parts of the Deep South. We certainly don't have an exclusive on these issues, but the Deep South undoubtedly was and remains ground zero in terms of the devastating impact of the country's worst forms of neglect and abuse. My organization, HOPE, operates in a region that has the highest level of poverty in the country. In Mississippi, 62% of our residents don't have 3 months of savings. Almost 40% of my members in our credit union didn't have a bank account before they joined HOPE. There's similar statistics for educational attainment, health, and other indicators of well-being, and in every circumstance, they're worse for people of color. For example, 72% of African Americans in Arkansas are either unbanked or underbanked. 52% of black children in Mississippi live in poverty, compared to 19% of the white kids. A full one-quarter of all the nation's persistently impoverished counties, that's counties that have had over 20% poverty for three decades in a row, are in our footprint. Fortunately, over the past 20 years, we've made some progress and we've learned a lot about what it takes to help people in communities improve their station. I'm particularly excited about the role that the CDFI sector has played in this space and the number of people that we've been able to assist over the past 20 years. That's an illustration of what smart policy can do to stimulate investment in low-income communities. Today, this vagabond group of do-gooders has evolved into more than 800 CDFIs that are part of the nation's financial sector, a relatively small part, but a significant, sophisticated, and invaluable part of the financial sector. Just ask the people who, in the wake of the financial crisis, were able to support their families, escape from debt traps, and keep their homes, often their only asset, because of CDFIs. This was true for thousands of people after Hurricane Katrina and Hurricane Sandy as well. By lowering, and technology is a game changer. By lowering costs and making distance more and more irrelevant, it seems like every few days, amazing new technology and innovative thinkers are creating ways to serve people at a lower cost. This is a platform that we can build on. At our credit union, at HOPE, thousands of members living in small rural communities that don't have a bank in their or HOPE branch are using our mobile and online services to scan their checks for deposit, to access their account balances, to make loan applications online remotely, and access affordable and responsible financial services. Every day, we're opening individual development accounts, child savings accounts. We're restructuring debt for hardworking people who have taken on 7, 8, 9, 10 payday loans to deal with an emergency and then find themselves sinking deeper and deeper in quicksand. Almost 90% of our mortgages last year and quite frankly, throughout history, have been to first-time homebuyers. But that's particularly noteworthy in the past few years when much of the mortgage industry is still stuck in the mud. In addition to becoming an asset owner, in our surveys of new homeowners, they report that they now live in safer communities, that kids have better educational opportunities, and they do better in schools. These are just a few of the new exciting developments, and the access to capital part of the assets field. But we need to take it to another level. Widening gaps between the haves and have-nots are getting worse and worse every day, as I said. These are exacerbated by growing diversity, which quite frankly is an asset if we make it one. Add to this near 1960s levels of intolerance, not just in the Mid-South either. It's getting worse across the country. Most of us are familiar with President Johnson's statement upon the passage of the Civil Rights Act. He said, unfortunately, in the launching of the war on poverty, he said, unfortunately, many Americans live on the outskirts of hope. Some because of their poverty, some because of their skin color, all too many because of both. Our task is to help replace their despair with opportunity. This administration today, here and now, declares unconditional war on poverty. Folks, we still need to finish the job that was started there. I'm unfortunately have to miss Thursdays and Fridays events to attend an event in Jackson with Merle Evers. Ms. Evers said that if her husband, Megger, had not been assassinated, he would be doing the type of work that we're all doing here at the Asset Learning Conference. This is the work that Martin Luther King was doing when he was shot in Memphis. Friends, economic justice is the unfinished work of the civil rights movement, and we cannot allow financial services to be absent from, or even worse, to become an extraction industry in our most vulnerable communities. We are better than that. So what do we do about it? I have a few opinions, but I'll save them for our discussion. Thank you. Now I'd like to invite my friend Bob Anibile.
Good morning, everyone. Morning. Andrea, thank you for your kind introduction and Bill. And it's humbling to speak after Bill and before the other colleagues on that panel there, and really to speak about an area that for a city has been a long area of interest and commitment. And I particularly want to thank my colleagues at City who've done so much to help inform me, and I'll give you the sense why Andrea said gave away how long I've been with City. Everybody can't believe it. But I mean, it was in many different places, in Athens and in Africa and the Middle East and London. And yet I would say one of your greatest assets at CFED is Brandy McHale, who's also a colleague and the vice chair of here, but also is the COO of our foundation, but who really introduced me to the concept, I think, of asset building. Because when I first did asset building, as a banker who'd been for a long time on treasury and other areas, I thought, okay, assets, that half of the balance sheet. And it took me a little time to realize just what we were really embarking on when we looked at a household's assets. And we didn't just mean literally their house or their home or their pension or car. We meant really would later be developed and thought through much more thoughtfully than I would have had when we got to liquid assets and liquid asset poverty. Andrea kicked off this morning talking about something else. It reminds us, we so often talk about global trends at Citi. Digitalization, globalization, and urbanization. Major trends that that affect the way we work and for many of us that are very urban-based, the way that we live. And yet when we look at inequality, insecurity, and immobility, we see a whole subsector that will not be able to take advantage of even the national or the global trends that some of us believe are where growth lies and where some of growth is being experienced today. The numbers, which I'm just too tempted to go back over, that others will speak of more eloquently, and Andrea began the day with, show that. They just show how many are being left behind. And yesterday, talking with Wade Henderson and others on the panel, we really thought about and very much said a theme for me that's so important, which is all about disaggregating the numbers. It's about disaggregating the headline and saying that economic growth and restoring growth in the country is phenomenal and so important. Unemployment going down to 6.2 or 6.1 is much better than being at 10%. We get it on a magnitude of change. But unless we disaggregate data, we realize that that trend is so one is so unshared. It is not indicative of what is being the reality for so many in the country. And how do we then leave behind so many, whether it's on a social, a political, or even on a business level, and think that that makes sense? And it doesn't. And it doesn't at all. The work that we looked at and I learned from internationally around financial inclusion and around microfinance really was framed around providing access to financial services and beginning often with savings, and increasingly the focus on savings, for the vast majority which are outside the financial system. But coming to work in the U.S. after so many years and thinking in terms always of platforms to reach scale and to serve the majority in a low-cost way that's inclusive and address needs, it became so surprising to see numbers that within our own society are staggering. We have numbers in places like Newark that you know, look very much like countries that I've worked in that I never thought I'd find before, and challenges that are very similar. Such unequal growth and financial services which have in many ways not kept up with that trend. Many of the financial services that all of us grew up with, from our community banks that many of us may have began with, and our credit unions and savings and loans and others, you know, to the large commercial banks, were growing through a period of prosperity that existed for decades, and where a middle class and others were experiencing growth. But we know over the last 20 years at least, that has not been the case for a very large segment. And that is what brings us much closer in thinking about business models that have to address, again, the majority, and think of new ways of serving the vast majority and those who are then in even more challenged situations differently. I think CFED has helped us frame our thinking and informed us at Citi, as have many of the people in this room. When I think of Michael, I think Ray Brochara is going to speak, and others. To me, they've all, in many ways, informed me and certainly our thinking about the landscape in the U.S. and the way it's being reached and served and the products that we all have. But we also have to think about that relationship between some very big terms that CFED has put forward: poverty, income, savings, assets, and liquid asset poverty. And the reality is that for many Americans, not just the poor anymore, we talk about liquid asset poverty. And I think it's also a calling for business and for government then to look for much broader policies that will resonate not only for those interested in the poor, because those are certainly an important group of constituents, but there are those many who keep talking about the middle class and realize the middle class, which is an aspiration in the way we all, so many identify ourselves, as someone said yesterday, even the wealthy often say, I'm middle class. You know, I'm middle class. We don't, unless you're very rich, you try not to say that you're other than that. Many of those are actually living the same experience of liquid poverty. And what it really means is we have a shared experience in vulnerability. And I think the fact that it goes deep into the middle class nowadays is something which should cause us to be able to build alliances, and to build alliances that can also reflect and work on areas such as tax reform, and which can be incentives. It's not only about taking tax benefits from 401ks and 529s and whatever other mechanisms exist today, but it's about balancing that with credits, not just tax credits, cash credits and incentives, and tools which, as the report that Andrea spoke about before, right-siding, upside down, I forget the title, but it's a wonderful pun on it, very much addresses that. And it's an area where we're trying to give further thought to it. What else do we do then, and what are we looking at to build assets? It's also to be awareness that asset building is going to be about a lot of tools. It's about credit building, about helping people to build their financial identity and their credit scores, because that brings down cost. That gives them choice in terms of financial services, many of which have depleted savings over the last years by lack of access. It's about citizenship and nationality as an asset. Getting people through to that last mile has a huge payoff. We look at the numbers of unbanked, we look at the numbers in poverty who are foreign-born but not citizens, and it's daunting, the difference. Today we announced a program with the mayors of Los Angeles, Chicago, and New York, really focusing cities on citizenship, on doing just that, on making sure the 9 million Americans, or not yet Americans, but who are eligible to Americans in the United States who haven't gone that last mile go there, so their children will be eligible for scholarships, jobs, and many other benefits that a national will receive in the U.S. It's about building assets of many different types. I think it is about being disarming. And in terms of businesses joining with others here, around areas like the tax reform and around regulatory reform, Bill and I spoke earlier too. We have, in many ways, financial services have looked back over 30 years and still look, in many ways, as they did. They're still built off of bricks and mortar. We still look at those branches or the marble palaces you see from town to town. And people have moved beyond that. And other industries have moved much faster and are reaching low income and poor. Whether it's the mobile operators and or any others, they've taken a new turn and a new twist on serving. And so for us, it's very much about looking at new products. We'll announce also this week a new access account product that, again, is very focused on making it more difficult to overdraft, as our debit cards never allowed you. Now none of those ACHs or transfers should allow it either and cause people to go into overdraft, but also to get people further and further on an easy entry account for those who've not been there before, and as Bill spoke of, using all the power of platforms, platforms that bring down cost and that are much more inclusive and frankly respond to people's needs and requests much greater. That's the point of, from a business perspective, I wanted to praise too. And that really was, how do we build platforms that are inclusive and low cost? Savings platforms, Andrea spoke of earlier, and we are involved in, whether it's the kindergarten to college platform in San Francisco or the very exciting new ones we look at that states are putting forward. It's also about transaction accounts as the one we're doing, but that we're doing with groups and with civil society, Grameen America and others. We feel one other exercise we need to do is look at business models that are about partnership for those who have the trust and the knowledge around those communities that are least served. Because the entry point is not enough to have a product. It needs to have a trust. It needs to have financial capability and outreach. And that is going to come, we think, much, much more from the work that will be done in partnership with many of yourselves. So from our business, it is about also transforming how we serve much deeper within the models that all of us have to operate in. But it can be done, we believe. It can be done through technology and through outreach and through innovation that the financial services sector is so much more informed by your work. So I look forward to over the next day, we'll talk more about other initiatives that are being launched. I'm delighted to have so many colleagues here and partners speaking and giving us, again, the information, the design, the ideas to transform some of this, which philanthropy has played, as Andrea said, an incredible role. It got us to where we are, and it needs to stay with us as you go further and further. But we need the businesses to engage and to be informed and to learn from that, just as we need policymakers. So with that, I look forward to speaking more over the next 2 days with many of you, and I transfer over to the podium to Lisa Haragawa from Capacity.
Good morning, everybody. As they said, my name is Lisa Hasegao. I'm the executive director of the National Coalition for Asian Pacific American Community Development, National Capacity for short. So I'm really pleased to be here with all of you. I'm very humbled to be on this panel with all of these asset building rock stars. I think I'm one of the newbies to the asset building field, but I've been with National Capacity for about 14 years, so I've been an avid student. So by now, I guess I should be in about middle of high school. So this is one of my, I felt like I was studying for an exam last night. I'm really happy to be here, and you know, just thank you to the CFED team and the whole CFED family for really welcoming me. I've learned a lot from you over the years. I'm here today to talk about a few ideas about how I think that you know, the organizers, the civil rights community, racial justice activists, and financial institutions, unlikely bedfellows in many worlds, how we can come together for policy change. So Andrea asked me to focus sort of on the kinds of work that we do here in Washington, D.C., and particularly from a lens of racial justice and economic vitality. Those are sort of the two pillars of the work that National Capacity capacity does. So some of you might think, and hopefully this is not a new concept to you, that there are many low-income Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders who also care and who also need a lot of the services that you all are working on. So we focus on issues for low-income Native Hawaiians, Pacific Islanders, Asian Americans. We have about 100 community-based organizations around the country, many of whom are here for their first time today. We have a little mini delegation of API community building, community asset building organizations. And I have to say that they may be new to the asset building field, but they are rock stars in the immigration reform debates and some of the other campaigns around wage theft and things like that. So I think that there are really some really exciting opportunities about how these different strands of movements are coming together. So Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders oftentimes are framed as the model minority. And I think that we are often used as a wedge community to sort of oftentimes by folks who are trying to dispel or to poke holes in the idea that race still matters. You know, we're in a post-racial society. Just look at those Asians who are doing so well, and, you know, race doesn't matter. They've been able to sort of transcend race. And so I think that that's why it's important, and I just thank Andrea for inviting us here today, because what I'm here today to say is that race still matters a lot, and that it's very important, I think, that Asian American and Pacific Islander communities, you know, are at the table as part of this conversation so that we're not used as a wedge, and that we have to understand that, you know, with the model minority, what the flip side of that is that there's an assumption of a problem minority, and that somehow we're pitted against African Americans and Latinos and saying that, you know, somehow, well, how come you can't be like the Asian Americans? And so I think that, you know, what we have been really doing at National Capacity is talking about to our own communities and to everyone else really about the structural racism in our community and some of the structural problems of why some of these inequalities exist. So I'm not going to go over some of the things that Andrea already talked about how 90% of the wealth in our country is held by white households and how so few is held by communities of color. But I think that that is something that is very important. So what are we going to do about that? What does that mean that there is such a huge racial wealth gap in this country? I think that, you know, one of the things I learned that that the income inequalities really are structural, that no amount of counseling is going to, you know, close the racial wealth gap. And I think that, you know, I only have to think about my own family who lost a lot of property in the wake of, you know, World War II and the internment camps. My family would have been in a very different asset situation had we not lost those many acres of lands that were strawberry farms. So I think I only have to think about my own family to understand that a lot of these things are structural. So what does all of this mean? So for it's been 50 years since the March on Washington. You know, Japanese Americans were there 50 years ago. And what organizers understood then and what still holds true today is that policy change is a real critical driver to helping us move the needle on economic and racial justice. That's really the only thing that's going to get at some of these structural issues. What I think is exciting is that, you know, the silver lining of a lot of this very depressing news about what's going on in the economy and what's going on in Ferguson and some of these touch points that have been happening in the last few years, I think is that there's a real growing dialogue about wealth inequality, about the racial wealth gap in the media. And there's a real, I think, desire for action. And I think that there's a much broader conversation that opens an opportunity for all of our movements to come together. We know that congressional action is limited. It's great that we're all going to be going on visits, but I think that this is really laying the groundwork for the work that we're going to be able to do in the future, and we have to be ready for opportunity. So we at National Capacity, for many years of the Republican administration, it was difficult, I think, to really kind of move the ball forward because people didn't want to talk about race. And people didn't want to talk about inequalities, and it was a difficult time to be here in D.C. but we were able to build an institution. And so while, you know, Congress is stalled, I think that there's a real opportunity for us to come together and to bring the immigration reform, the minimum wage fights, and a lot of these different movements together with the asset building movements so that we are ready for opportunity and that we're really aligned and see real common cause, and we have the relationships in place to be able to do really deep work together. Excuse me. I think that, you know, just to finish up, I think that, you know, every time I come to the CFED conference, you know, I look at the upside, you know, at first it was the upside down budget, and now it's upside down, right side up. I think that, you know, where there's a real opportunity is for the civil rights movement, communities of color, racial justice advocates. We don't have to recreate the wheel. You know, we want to really figure out how do we be a part of the solution, not just continue to call out, these are the problems, these are the inequalities, you know, and just sort of be in your face. It's like, we want to be a part of the solution. So I think that what I love about CFED and a lot of the work that you all are doing is that the tools and solutions are there, and I think that we can fast forward together and just build those relationships of trust. And so it's going to be exciting dialogue. We look forward to working with all of you. The Asset Building Policy Network is what Bob was talking about yesterday, and I think that it is an unusual partnership of civil rights groups and asset building folks and financial institutions, and I think that that's a seed for a lot of really exciting change. Thanks.
Okay, Lisa. It's a pleasure to be on the panel with Lisa and Bill and Bob and Andrea. It's great to be here. I would just like, without repeating, echo the shout outs to all the supporters and especially American Philanthropy. But also all the practitioners in the room. None of this happens without you, and you often are unheralded in the process. So I'd like to give a hand to all the people who are doing the work. And thank you, panelists, for your great remarks. It makes it easier for me. There are several things I don't have to say because of the excellent content that proceeded ahead of me. I'd just like to reinforce that we are in a rapidly increasing situation of economic inequality. I'd just like to add the point, it's implied in what's being said, that labor income alone is probably not going to be a sufficient idea for supporting households going forward. And this has been a kind of a bedrock assumption in the American economy and actually in the social welfare system, that it's labor income that is the bedrock, and then we have created welfare policies that have supported labor income. I think going forward we'll have to have a more complex idea that households require multiple kinds of support in addition to flows from labor income and flows from welfare supports. These are desirable, but probably not enough. And we have to have a more complex view of households that includes their asset positions and the stability they have from what they own and resources that they control that are not quite so dependent on the vagaries of the employment market. So this will be a big shift. And in fact, I guess my comments today are about these kinds of shifts and the kinds of worlds that we have to imagine, and I think we do have an imagination challenge ahead of us. So I want to shift to that imagination challenge, and let's start with where we are now with this asset building structure that's in the private market, but especially I think in public policy. This is what I think about most of the time, and it's been mentioned that the asset building strategies that we have in public policy are highly regressive. The top 1% gets a huge portion of the income. In our terms in this room, I think we would turn to the 401k system, which is, in my view, largely broken. It doesn't really serve the country very well. Half the people in the country don't even have access to it, don't have a job where they have access to a 401k plan. And of the people who do have access, most of the benefits go to the very top. I mean, a surprising portion of the benefits go to the top. Top 1% of people participating in 401k plans have plans with millions of dollars of benefits or accumulations, and they continue to get tax benefits for that. And 50% of the population doesn't even have access to such a plan. So there's no possible way that this is a good governance. This is a deeply flawed view of what a government policy should be, and we need to turn that around. So it's easy to say that, but it's a little harder to imagine what to do about it. So I'm gonna go take my couple of minutes. I'm on yellow already. Oh, good. This is not easy for a college professor, 7 minutes, you know. Okay, so let's have a little imagination exercise. So first imagination exercise is that we today have running water. This is a tribute to, or this is a tip of a hat to Fred Goldberg here. This is about the plumbing. We have running water in our houses. We get up, we turn on the water, we have clean water every day. We don't think about it. But that didn't always exist. It used to be that people had to get their bucket in the morning and go out and get their own water. Some of them couldn't find water. Some people found water that was not safe to drink and needed to be boiled. So we figured out that it would be better for everyone, easier, free up a lot of human resources, and people would be healthier if they just had water running in their house. Before that happened, people would have had a hard time imagining that, but today we take it completely for granted. So that's one example. The other example is a little difference about it's about driving. Some of us are not as good a drivers as we should be. We know who we are. My wife is down here. She's nodding her head. So we have structured driving a little bit. We have roads, and you're supposed to stay on one side of the road, not the other side. And we have stop signs, and we have speed limits. So we have rules, and that has helped a little bit. But humans still, you know, we're not always on the right side of the road. Some of us don't always see the stop sign and so on. So it turns out that, you know, humans are not really very good at driving, and the data will show that. It's probably pretty crazy to have humans driving thousands of pounds of metal down the road, and, you know, some of them texting or whatever they're doing. So, and fortunately, Google and some other people are figuring out that how to have cars drive down the road that really drive themselves. And in my view, this will be a great thing. Probably... in a decade or two, all of our car, or three, I don't know how long it will take, all of our vehicles, whatever they're called at that point, will be going down the road, and humans will be taken out of the equation largely, and that will be a great thing. And we will look back and have a hard time imagining what it was like when humans were really in control of these things, right? So just that's an imagination issue that currently in transition. I think financial services and building wealth is pretty much the same. It's very clear from a lot of studies in behavioral economics that humans are not very good at this. We don't do this well. The systems that are in place sometimes don't serve us well. So the imagination problem here is, you know, is there a way to get to a set of financial services and capabilities and building assets that's pretty much like running water in your house? Now, I know that sounds hard to imagine, but I think that will happen eventually, and I think after it does happen, we will look back and think, well, gosh, how did people ever do it any other way? So that's the imagination problem I would like to leave with you today. We do have work going on at the Center for Social Development. Ford Foundation has been a great supporter, testing the idea of a universal and automatic account at birth, and that's in the Seed for Oklahoma Kids project in Oklahoma. We do have very positive results with that. We have shown that 100% of people can participate, and we have shown that those participants have accumulated assets over time, even through the recession. Our Seed OK participants now have more money in their account than when they started at the beginning of the recession, and there are very few households in America that can say that about their assets, because humans have been involved. So So it is possible to structure a universal system. We have used these data. Also, we have shown that the mothers of these children in the treatment group have higher expectations for their children's education, and that in some ways the mother's mental health is better, and in some ways the child development is better. So this is not just a material effect, it's an effect on people's outlooks and aspirations that we have empirically demonstrated. And that research has affected state policy already in several states. Maine now has a universal automatic account at birth. Other states are going toward universal policy. So this is not pie in the sky. If we can start every child with an account in Maine and other states, then eventually we could have a national policy, which could be a platform, I very much like the title, Platforms for Prosperity, a platform for a lifetime of asset accumulation that people can use to invest in their future. So keep your imagination hat on at this conference. Be asking the questions, you know, will this get all people in? Is this really a system that is serving everyone with the plumbing and does everyone have a car that drives itself? I think we have a lot of imagining to do and still a lot of empirical research to do and a lot of practice to do. I want to thank CFED for organizing us to get it done. Thank you very much.
Please join me in thanking this extraordinary panel. So I'm going to try to channel everybody out there, right? And ask the question that you really want to ask. And I can't imagine a better frame than Michael's imagination challenge. So I'd like to start with you, Michael, and go down this way and ask you two questions. What gives you the most hope first? And then which challenge, as you look out to the 1,200 people, unless some of them are still sleeping, would you most want us to tackle together?
Thank you, Andrea. I actually have quite a lot of hope. I'm basically a nerdy type. We do applied research. So we have a very good research project happening that's having very interesting results, and these results are being, you know, having an effect in the field. And actually, Margaret Clancy on my staff is here. Margaret leads this work. We have a lot of policy work happening in a lot of states now. So I'm really, and this is our little corner of what's happening in this room. Other people are doing many other things. But I have a lot of hope because I think research really does matter, and we really are affecting the discussion in a positive way. And I think people are beginning to think about, well, how can you bring everyone in? How can every kid have an account? So I'm actually more than hopeful. I think this is inevitable, but I think we will go there, but we just have to find the pathway.
What makes me the most hopeful? I think that the organizing infrastructure in immigrant communities is very hopeful. And the partnership between immigrant communities, undocumented young people, and African Americans, like with the Dream Defenders and the Dreamers, I think that those are some of the things that give me the most hope, because I think that the organizing and the organizers out there, the movements, are hungry to be a part of the solution. And I think that that's the kind of shoe leather on the ground. Like, we have ground troops out there now, I think, to really be able to deploy, who are the trusted advisors out there, to be able to get folks to trust institutions, like financial institutions, or even government agencies, to be able to actually ensure that some of the products and policy changes that we fight so hard for in DC actually are accessible to those that are most disconnected.
I think I'm hopeful, and I'm optimistic, and I'm kind of excited about this whole movement. I mean, you've built this enormous movement, but that you've at this stage you've shown there's been test cases, there's real research,
there's data. And I think it's so important to have come out from what is easy to be anecdotal about and very vivid and truthful, but it's not enough. It's not enough to build public policy off of. It's not enough to build a broader set of stakeholders. I'm sort of hopeful that because of your liquid poverty work is a perfect example, is that many more people will realize that the need for platforms that are inclusive, that are low cost, are not just about the poor. And it's very easy to just say, well, this is a special group. We have to look at everything. Of course, we have to look at everything for all segments. But that many segments of our communities are today struggling. And we're not building assets from very youthful age right on up. And we're depleting them through some of our other services. So I think that is allowing for a much more dynamic discussion at the municipal, the state level, I hope at the federal level. But I think it's happening. And I think we'll get, you know, that disarming group of us, you know, hopefully when we meet with them together, sort of striking them that, you know, there's really a need for public policy, tax policy, and others to keep up with this movement.
You know, I really think we are at a really interesting time in this discussion in this country. And I think, you know, think about it. When Standard & Poor's sounds the alarm about the risks of income inequality to the economy, I think it gets people's attention. It's not like our Mississippi Economic Policy Center saying it or CFED saying it.
Right.
I think when a Standard & Poor's says it, when the financial sector and the business community coughs, policy makers tend to make sure they don't get pneumonia. And so I'm hopeful that the growing chorus of voices that are focusing on the risks, not just to people in the Mississippi Delta, but to people in communities and people in neighborhoods next to theirs, are facing as a result of this growing gap, that we'll have some of the momentum that it takes to actually make some real policy change. As I said earlier, I think the CDFI industry is an example of what can happen when an idea gets support. President Clinton, you know, saw in his communities in Arkansas what was possible with these kinds of smart investments. Then folks like Frank DiGiovanni at Ford and investors and banks started to get behind this, and we built an industry that quite frankly didn't exist 20 years ago. And now we've got billions of dollars in tax credits, hundreds of millions of dollars in bond financing. It doesn't always work the way we want it to work, but it's resources that are targeted and intended to address some of these gaps. So I think that the growing focus on these issues gives us a window to really affect policy change that we have to take advantage of.
So our last question, because I know Kim's looking at me very penetratingly, is if there's one new thing that we're talking about in 2016, what would you want it to be? And this is really saying to Michael, we're all in this imagination challenge. And I'll ask Bob to start.
2016. I think I really look at the ability, I hate to say it's so boring sometimes, but tax reform. I think being able to address some of this enormous shift of capital inequality. We have to raise incomes, disposable incomes, savings income, don't dispose of it, but of the low income and poor, which is a very big segment. Without that, there's very little optimism or faith by those communities that they can truly progress. Without the income to make it through the month, and I think your minimum wage would be very helpful, and tax reform, it's very hard for people to feel that they can save and look for the future.
Bill.
No, I get in the weeds. I'm a practitioner. we try to do things, and I really love Michael's challenge. I want to look further, but every day you've got to get to work and make sure that people have the tools they need to succeed. And I know that while we as practitioners have done some pretty impressive things with relatively few resources, we don't have all the resources we need. We need to scale up what works. You know, we have foundations that have stayed with us, And we have banks that invest where there are CRA opportunities to invest, but we need to scale up what works and then take that and take the practice, move it, take the data and move it to policy, inform our decision makers, the deciders, and then we've got to apply pressure, organizing. So policy, practice, policy, and organizing to make sure that these voices are heard, that policymakers can't ignore the will of the people. And I'll focus on CRA. Bob and I talked about that a bit. We are in a donut hole in terms of bank branches from the mega banks. And so there's not the incentives, there's not the structure. CRA is an antiquated, broken law. But regulators are hesitant, and the Congress are hesitant to open it up because they're scared that it'll be cut up, and taken apart. People blamed it for the too many loans to low-income people created the financial crisis. We know that's a bunch of what it is, but that was the case. And so, how do we make be bold and be innovative and make the policies that are on the books that require that banks invest in communities where they extract profits? Bob said he would love to do it, he's working in a broken regime. We know that CFPB, other agencies are starting to look at ways to level the playing field. We've got to make those things work, and hopefully in 2016, we'll the combination of practice, policy, and pressure will move us there a little bit more effectively.
It's a great new phrase for us. Yes. Lisa, because I'm going to give Michael the final word.
Sure. Well, when you say 2016 to me, I think election. So I presume that's what you were referring to. And so in 2016.
Actually, I was referring to the next asset learning conference.
Oh,
we'll
okay.
Talk about
yes,
the election
of course.
Too.
The next ALC conference. I think election, so both are happening in 2016, which is good planning. But I think that there's a whole investment by a lot of funders and foundations and a lot of attention and interest over the last couple of election cycles in civic engagement. And I think that what I would love to see happen in 2016 is in that all of the town hall meetings that are going to be organized by the immigration reform folks, by the minimum wage organizers, that they're talking about the right side up budget. They're talking about child savings accounts. That they're talking about some of the things that the asset building field is talking about as policy solutions, and that they are demanding that accountability from the folks that are running for office. So I think that that's what I imagine happening, and I think it's doable.
I'm with Lisa.
Yay!
I think by 2016, there's a lot of momentum now with children's accounts. So this is the little vehicle we're working with. I think it's important because it's making the point of everyone in and everyone really a life potential for a lifelong account. So a lot of activity in the states, and I think by 2016, I would like to say every state would have this, but I think that's optimistic. But I think it's possible that like 10 states could be doing this by 20. I think that's within reach. If that happens, and I think the discussion reaches a whole new plane. The subtext of that, longer term, I think, is that begins. We're using the 529 structure, which is also regressive, of course. But that begins to put on the table, well, why should some households get such large tax benefits in this structure, and other households have little or none? So that's, and as Bob says, that's the discussion that will really eventually make a difference. So that's my.
So please join me thanking our panel. Now, before we go off to the impossible choice of the 18 sessions you get to choose among, we're gonna have the athletic part of the morning, all right? So be prepared. So first, I just wanna say a little bit about who's here. We have so far 1,200 people registered for this conference. And one of the things about Kim is that she always reminds me
that lots of people do things at the last minute, which is not my modus operandi. So she's going to give us an update by the end of the day based on how many people registered today. So we have people from 47 states. I don't know where Rhode Island, Wyoming, or Alaska are. Do we have? Oh, Nevada. Oh, look what they came with. We're already, Lisa, at the 2016 election, I want you to know. We have the most folks from the District of Columbia, 199, and one person, do they want to stand up, from North Dakota. We also have international attendees. We have 6 people from Canada, 1 person from Japan, and 1 person from the United Kingdom. And then almost half of you are here for the first time, and that makes me so excited. Would all of you who are here for the first time stand up? Wow. So far, we have 500 people going to Capitol Hill, which is a record by far, to show the strength of the movement. So everybody who's going to Capitol Hill, please stand up. All right, look at that. Now, stay standing. In addition, we have the largest representation of the Assets and Opportunity Network. Many of you are already standing, but those of you who are not from the Assets and Opportunity Network, stand up, please. And we have a special Native Nations Caucus, and we would like you to stand too. So, fabulous, thank you. Bob Friedman, CFED's founder and resident visionary, always says that a field and as a movement, the whole is greater than the sum of its part. And never is there a better reminder of this great piece of wisdom than when I look out and see all of you, and we believe completely that it is your dedication, your ingenuity, your passion that when combined will make wealth and income inequality an artifact of history. So clap for yourselves. I want to give you 2 updates from when we last met 2 years ago. You may have remembered that we announced the launch of a new social venture called the One-to-One Fund that makes it easy for children's savings programs to engage donors, large and small, to help kids save for college. You heard all this wonderful forecasting about children's savings accounts. Since that time, we've grown from 2 pilot sites to a total of 7 one-to-one sites. They're all here at the conference, and have helped our partners raise almost $500,000 in match. And you will all have a chance to help increase that number tomorrow night. Another way that we have helped to expand the marketplace for asset building is through the support of the Assets and Opportunity Network, which we launched at this very conference 2 years ago. In the closing plenary, you'll hear about the significant accomplishments of the network and what they have achieved. We did a survey just last week because we had really nothing to do, right? Which documented that over 80% of the members of the network said that the demand for financial capability and asset building services had increased. They had done their best to meet the demand, but needs more resources to do more of that, which we'll be discussing over the next 3 days. So, one reason we are so big this year is the generosity of our 22 sponsors, who together are providing scholarships for practitioners and advocates and underwriting over 300 speakers and moderators on the program. We're gonna have their logos flash by the screen, and I'm going to announce each one. I want them to stand up and keep standing as I announce their names. They get special exercise today. And let's hold our applause until the end. So let's start with Citi, our premier sponsor. Have a good example, stand up. Then I invite JP Morgan Chase, MetLife Foundation, and Prudential, our marquee sponsors. Everybody stand up. Bank of America, our emerald sponsor. Wells Fargo, our platinum level sponsor. Capital One, Intuit, and MasterCard, our gold sponsors. NeighborWorks America and LexisNexis Risk Solutions, our silver sponsors. Our many bronze sponsors, BB&T Bank, the Center for Financial Services Innovation, E-Trade, and Ideas 42. Our special level sponsors, Charles Schwab Bank, the Asset Building Policy Network, and the Northwest Area Foundation. And our additional sponsors, Allstate and the Capital Area Asset Builders, who have supported the beautiful notebooks and water bottles you received in your bags. Please join me in giving a huge round of support. I also, some of you are going to have to stand up again, want to recognize in alphabetical order the sponsors of the Platforms for Prosperity contest. The awards that recognize the innovation and impact in the field, which we're going to give out tomorrow night. When we thought about giving a special award this year, we wanted to recognize the incredible advances that's happening in the field, and that's what this contest is all about. Bank of America, who sponsored Where We Live conference, please stand up. Citi for the Where We Bank contest. MetLife for Where We Get Comprehensive Services. Morgan Stanley for Where We Start Businesses. And Prudential for Where We Work. So one more great round of applause. So before I send you on your way, let me just tell you a little bit more about what's happening over the next 3 days. As I said before, the Platforms for Prosperity contest will be celebrated in a special awards program where we'll also recognize leaders of the Native American asset building field and celebrate our 65th birthday with a musical surprise, not Kanye West, I can tell you that, delicious food and birthday cake. Over the next 3 days, we'll be holding over 80 sessions, 54 concurrent sessions, 5 plenaries, a dozen roundtables, and 5 capacity building intensive, most developed in partnership with sponsors and with you from the field. I know personally how difficult it will be to choose. I have roller skates to go around, although they don't work very well on the escalator. These sessions are the essence of our movement and provide a roadmap for the future. Would all the moderators, presenters, and panelists who are bringing up these sessions please stand to be thanked? So let's not forget, tonight we're going to have a DC Street Fair reception and exhibitor crawl with fun game and prizes, DC-themed food and signature drinks. Would all the exhibitors who are going to be there tonight stand up so we can recognize them? All right, thank you. And make sure you go there because there's a big prize on the line tonight. I really sound like a carnival gal, don't I? So as I close, rather than waiting to the end of the event, let me ask all the CFED staff who have worked on this conference to stand and be recognized, along with the core planning team, many of which are behind the curtain. So would all the CFED people please stand? I say from the bottom of my heart that it's the greatest gift to work with these people. So thank you. And I'm very grateful that almost the entire CFED board of directors are here. And I'd like to ask them to stand so everybody can see them and come up to them with their suggestions over the next 3 days. Would you all please stand? And then finally, I want to thank the entire team at the Marriott. Many people came up to me and they said, did you realize how big a risk you were taking when you decided to pick a hotel that was only going to be open 4 months before? Well, what has happened is we've never had a more cooperative and eager to please staff in all the conferences we've ever done. So with that, I want to thank them, Conference Direct, who's organized the incredibly cool thing where there's not even like a big pile of materials. You just get all your stuff. Our friends at Ohm Production, who did this marvelous thing, then you're gonna see lots more over the next 3 days, and all the volunteers whose mastery of social media will get us trending. And with that, go forth and conquer. Thank you.